So in our discussion of the testes, we talked about one of the main support systems in terms of that, and that's going to be the scrotum. Now, there are a few layers that we want to talk about. When we think about it, we typically think of it as almost like a skin sac, and that's exactly, there is what we refer to as scrotal skin. And scrotal skin is going to have a lot of things associated with it. It's going to be hair-bearing, it's going to have sebaceous or oil glands, as well as sudoriferous glands as well. And specifically when we're talking about those sudoriferous or sweat glands, these are going to be those apocrine sweat glands that are going to produce smell or produce odor. Also, what's unique in terms of, or what's specific we want to talk about with the skin is it's going to be highly pigmented as well in comparison to other areas of the body. Now, deep to the skin, you're going to have your subcutaneous layer. This isn't really going to consist of fat like you would have in most subcutaneous layers. It'll be a very small amount, and by very small, I mean very small amount of fat in this region. But really what I want to talk about is this dartos muscle. So you're going to have this dartos muscle that's going to form and be within this subcutaneous layer. And dartos muscle is going to be a smooth muscle, so it's going to be sympathetically innervated. And what happens when the dartos muscle contracts is that it's going to contract and kind of move up the scrotum, okay? And this will do so as a in terms of a reflex associated with really cold environment, and we'll talk about that in a bit more specifics as well. Now, very closely associated to the dartos muscle is the cremaster muscle, and we'll talk about this one in a bit more detail when we talk about the spermatic cord, because it's going to really be surrounding that spermatic cord, but it's going to have a very similar role in terms of when it contracts based on coming into contact with some type of cold environment, that's going to allow for the testes to kind of ascend and get closer to the actual body. Now, one other thing we want to note here, within the scrotum, right kind of down the medial portion is what's referred to as the medium raphae. And this is going to be almost completely avascular. So in terms of any type of incision that needs to be made in the scrotum, this is often an area where you can safely avoid any type of vascular supply. And as we discussed with the testes, this is going to be suspended within the by the spermatic cords, and those spermatic cords are going to have a portion of it that's also located within the scrotum. So we're looking at an image here in terms of the scrotum. You can see that the skin is going to be a bit more highly pigmented in this region. Now you don't see very clearly in terms of this individual a median raphae, which would be right down the middle here, but you can kind of see in terms of this elevation of the skin in this region where the spermatic cords are entering into this region here. All right, so what is going to be the main function of the scrotum? Well, obviously we're going to have support for the testes, both by that skin as well as the subcutaneous layer. But really importantly, it's going to play a big role in terms of the regulation of the temperature of the testes. In order for spermatogenesis to occur, spermatogenesis works best in terms of being at a certain degree, about 2 to 3 degrees Celsius lower than body temperature. So that's one of the main reasons why the testes are located outside of the body and referred to as external genitalia. So that location plays a big role. And then that dartos muscle and cremasteric muscle, when they contract, if they are interacting with any type of cold environment, that will allow for not only the scrotum to contract and kind of move superiorly, but as well as the spermatic cord as well, which is actually suspending the testes. Now, there is a very rich supply to the scrotum, so not only what's going to eventually supply that spermatic cord in the testes, but the actual skin and subcutaneous layer itself. You're going to have branches of the internal pudendal, which is going to be a branch of your internal iliac. Your inferior epigastric, which is going to be your external iliac, a branch of your external iliac artery, and femoral artery is also the larger branch of the external iliac. In terms of innervation, you're going to have contributions both from the lumbar plexus, in terms of your ilioinguinal and your genitofemoral, as well as your sacral plexus. So a very rich innervation and arterial supply in this region. Now, as we discussed in terms of the discussion for the testes, we know that the testes are going to form within the abdomen, or they're going to develop within the abdomen, and then descend eventually into the scrotum. And typically that happens around 7 months, but in certain cases that can actually not occur. It actually will not descend into the scrotum. And if this does occur bilaterally, that can have some very serious implications because it will stay within the body. So it's subject to the higher temperatures that you would have in the body as opposed to within the scrotum, where you're about 2 to 3 degrees lower temperature in the scrotum. Now, often, even if an individual is born without a complete descent of the testes, typically that will happen spontaneously around 3 months, or up to a year. Generally, if it has not done so, some type of surgical intervention can play a role in order to allow for infertility not to occur from the descent not occurring. So we've talked about the scrotum. Now we're going to talk about the specifics in terms of the spermatic cord, not only in terms of the coverings, but as the contents.